Hello everyone. I'm Praveen this side, and I hope so. Like अभी सब लोग जो लोग को भी आना था वो लोग सब आ चुके हैं. So today is a very special day. So Mr. Abhishek Sancheti, he has like spared some time, and today he is going to conduct the CV building workshop for us. And recently, like he has got admitted to I am Bangalore. He also got calls from lot other institutions. Okay, so he has done his graduation from Sri Ram College of Commerce, Eco Department. So I have requested him to conduct a CV building workshop because he has been doing this since the last 2 to 3 years. He was in the placement cell of his college, and he was heading the placement cell as well. So Abhishek, we request you to start the session, and if you all have any queries, then you all can ask sir after the end of the session. Okay, thank you.
So hi everyone, I hope I am audible. Sir bolne ka koi zarurat nahi hai. I think I may be junior to a lot of you or equal age. Bhaiya works if anything else. And yes, as obviously, Praveen Bhaiya has given a lovely introduction of mine. I am Abhishek Sancheti. I am a 21 fresher eco graduate from SRCC, and I would be joining IIM Bangalore this year for the batch of 23rd. And yes, I was in the placement cell of Sri Ram College of Commerce for last 3 years for that matter. And I had conducted a lot of recruitment types. Being a part of the placement cell, I was conducting the recruitment types of McKinsey, Bain, BCG, Parthenon, EY. Then we have JP Morgan Chase, American Express, and so on and so forth. So even though I do not consider myself to be fully to know everything that there is to know about resume building, but I think that I have a fair share of idea after seeing a lot of CVs of like being in the placement cell. I used to see a lot of CVs and getting feedback from a lot of recruiters about CVs. So I think I have a fair idea about that. And I would like to like discuss some of those ideas with you as well, if that would be okay. So I'll share my screen with you right now. Yeah, so I think you all can see my screen. I take you across some of the common mistakes that there are in CVs and what all should be there in a good CV and how actually companies shortlist candidates on the basis of the CVs. I think these are the main pointers that I want to cover in this session. But before that, I like to keep the session interactive. So if anyone could like tell me what do you mean by a CV, that would be very great. Anyone?
May I speak?
Yeah, sure.
So it's a document basically where we mention all our achievements and accomplishments, which will help us present our qualities to the company where we are applying for.
Okay, that's good. Anyone else?
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a person summary regarding his qualification, education, and his hobbies, achievement, etc.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone?
In short, I guess it is a valuation of a person.
Okay, so it's a valuation of a person. Yeah. Yes. Is there anyone who would like to add any point to that? So yeah, I think as rightly said by few of you, CV basically tells you, CV is basically a selling point of yours, right? You present a CV to an interviewer or to a company. You give your CV and you say that, hey, this is my CV. This is what I have done in my life. and you have to judge me basis on that one single page of document, right? So a particular good CV, I think, should contain your achievements, your qualifications, a little about you, your hobbies, if it may, and other extracurricular achievements that you may have. But these are all secondary points. The first thing that your CV should do is it should be a great talking point. Now, what do I mean by talking point here, right? So let's say you give, you like apply to X number of companies, you are shortlisted in X number of companies, and there is an, and you have an interviewer, let's say with ABC company, right? Okay. So the interviewer of ABC company, he does not know you, right? So all he has to get familiar with you is that one interview and that one page CV, which he has beforehand, right? So what, when he looks at that CV, he is trying to understand whether you would be a good fit for that company and whether do you have the necessary qualifications that are necessary for the job you are applying, right? These are the two things that the recruiter is concerned with, right? And he has that one page CV to look at, and he has an interview with you to decide on both of these topics, right? So your CV should serve as a talking point, right? Because he wants to know you better. The recruiter wants to know you better, that whether you are a good fit for the company or not. So it should serve as a talking point. Firstly, it should give him a lot of talking points. And when I mean by and what do I mean by talking point, I'll come to that later. But it should give the recruiter a lot of talking points, let's say an achievement, or let's say a work experience, or let's say an internship that you have done, where he can ask questions about the work that you do or whatever achievement you had, and he can get to know you better, right? So that should be one of the main qualities of a CV, that I feel that it should serve as a talking point. It should help you drive the interview and at the end get the job that you want, right? So a CV should function as a talking point as well. That is very important. Apart from that, I think the major mistake that a lot of people do in making CVs is that they make a CV very long, right? Just picture yourself as a recruiter. Okay, let's say you are recruiting for your company. You are the main HR head or main, let's say, the manager or stuff like that, and you are recruiting an individual. If an individual gives you a 5-page CV, will you read that? Obviously not, right? You won't read through 5 pages of CV and look for stuff that you have done, right? So a CV should be concise. And it's a consensus among, like, let's say, all the top B schools and as well as undergrad schools, that a CV should not exceed more than 1 page. Like, the 1 page is the most a CV should be, right? A 1-page CV with 1200 words, 800 to 1200 words is the best, which is considered, right? So it's a CV should never be long, and it should not contain unnecessary information. It should help the recruiter gauge you, understand you, understand what all achievements you had, give him a few talking points, and after that, it's upon you how you drive the interview, how you conduct yourself in the interview that helps you land the job, right? So in landing a job, a CV has two particular points. Firstly, the CV helps you getting a shortlist. It helps you getting a shortlist for the interview calls. And secondly, a CV helps in acts as a talking point during the interview. So a CV has to perform these two tasks. Okay, and there are specific different metrics for each and every task, and I will cover that as well. So let's start with the first task, how to get your CV shortlisted for, let's say, any XYZ company, right? So before I tell you how it is shortlisted, let's see how a CV is actually built, right? And what are the parameters on which a lot of different companies shortlist candidates on the basis of the CV. So I think my screen is visible with you. I'll share. Yeah. So can you see the CV? Please, anyone respond. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So this is one of the sample CVs that we have. Now see, for a lot of you, like I asked Praveen Bhaiya, which all companies you are targeting for, and he said that there's a lot of consulting companies, a lot of actuarial companies, a lot of finance and IB companies as well, right? So you are looking at a wide spectrum of companies, and each different class of companies has a different way of shortlisting. Let's say for companies, like for consulting companies like McKinsey, Bain, BCG, Parthenon, EY, A.T. Kearney, they have a different metric for shortlisting students on the basis of the CV, whereas finance companies like JP Morgan, American Express, Nomura, they have a different metric. So I'll talk about the consulting metric first, because that is more CV oriented, that looks at your entire CV per se. So all consulting companies majorly have four. They shortlist your CV basis on the basis of the marks that you score on the CV. So they have a marking system for each and every CV that they see. They have a total of 40 marks, which is divided into four categories, 10 marks for each category. The first category is educational qualifications. The second category is internships and work experience. For a fresher, it's only internship. And for fresher, the other two main categories are, thirdly, positions of responsibilities, which you have held in, let's say, college or school. And fourth, extracurricular achievements. So these are basically the four categories that, and this is, I'm talking about freshers only. These are the four categories which consulting companies look for. And they grade you basis on each of these categories out of your CV. And they have a cutoff list. Like for McKinsey, the cutoff score is 38 out of 40. So out of these four brackets, you have to at least score 38 on your CV out of the total 40 possible marks to get a shortlist for McKinsey. This is their criteria. So the first bracket, so in CV, the first bracket that there is actually educational qualifications, which it's basic. It contains your the entire qualifications, the educational qualifications that you had till that point of time. And it's very important that you have these educational qualifications in descending order, right? So you start with your latest educational qualification first. Let's say you have completed an actuarial paper in the recent month of, let's say, May. So you add that on the top of the list. And after that, as the according to the descending order, you add all the other educational qualifications. So class 10, class 12 should be at the bottom because they do not matter so much, right? The recruiter would be looking at your recent qualification. So you should maintain it in a descending order. As you can see in here as well, this is a sample CV which is given in SRCC. It's your college marks should be first, then your class 12 marks, then your class 10 mark, right? So this should be the pattern that you should all follow for educational qualifications. And it's very simple to get a 10 out of 10 here. If you have, let's say, good marks in BCom, in your undergraduate course and your class 12th, class 10, 90%, 90%, and let's say 8.5 GPA plus, you will easily score a 10 out of 10. That's not an issue. Apart from that, the other box, so we divide CV into a lot of buckets, right? So our first bucket is educational qualification. Then the next bucket that we talk about is academic achievements and awards. So let's say you have any academic achievement, you won a lot of certificates. Let's say you won a lot of certificates from your school, you were highest ranked, you got the highest marks in class 10th or class 12th, or let's say in a graduation, in a subject, you were all India topper in, let's say, CBSE, or in the all India topper in actuarial paper. These all go into there, right? So any scholarships, any awards, achievements, medals, merit certificates, any examination, any certification in a relevant course, you can all add in this box. That's the academic achievement and awards box. This coupled with educational qualifications forms your first bucket out of 10. So a scoring a 10 out of 10 in this is not that really difficult. It can be easily scored. After that, the next bucket that we talk about is the internship and work experience. Now, this is the bucket that we have to be very careful with, right? So a lot in internships, I have seen a lot of CVs there where they write the name of the company. Let's say they write XYZ company and write work they have not actually done, right? So let's say writing DCF analysis or stuff like that, which they have never like ever done in their internship stint, or writing very high level stuff that they actually do not do just for the sake of it, right? Because they got it, let's say, vetted, or let's say they got it, the approval of the manager to write it. But the internship is your one of the main talking points in your CV, right? So it's very important that in your internship or in your work experience, you write stuff that you actually did, because the manager would be most interested in this, let's say the recruiting manager or the recruiting person would be most interested in this bucket only. He or she will like to ask you a lot of questions on the internship or the work experience bucket and would like to know what did you actually did, right? So if you write actual stuff that you did, even though it's not great, it reflects good on your part, because you actually wrote what is the truth, instead of writing stuff, making up languages like you did XYZ thing and XYZ thing, which you never did, because managers are really good at catching this. And this is one of the feedbacks that the placement cell receives from a lot of companies that a lot of the students write stuff they have never done in their internship and they get caught in the interview, right? So even though you get shortlisted till the interview, there's zero chance of you going ahead from that because you will get caught at the interview and it's over for you, right? So internships are a very important thing because internships serve as a great talking point. Let's say if you are applying for a job of an IB, right? Investment banker, an analyst in, let's say, or an analyst in a consulting company. If you have done a consulting internship, let's say in a boutique firm or in a lower grade firm, and you write that you have done a consulting project or you did this, then it helps and serving as a talking point, right? Because you can connect with the interviewer, connect with the company that, yeah, see, this is the type of thing that was expected me to be done in the job description. And I have already did this, right? I have already proven my worth by doing this thing in the internship itself. You can talk a lot about this point with the recruitment manager, or let's say with the manager in the interview, and it can help you score points and it can help you convert the interview easily, right? So internships play a very huge importance. Internships or work experience, if you have, it plays a very huge importance in, like, for interviews and for getting shortlists. So this bucket is very, very important. Apart from that, the other bucket that is, like, for freshers, it's important is the positions of responsibility. Like, if you were, let's say, the president of a society in your college, or let's say a member of technical member, coordinator of a fest, stuff like that, then you can, like, put those things in the position of responsibility bucket, right? Now, what role does this play in your interview and in your CV? It also acts as a talking point, right? Let's say you were the technical coordinator of a fest that happened, let's say in Kolkata, or in a you managed a fest, or you conducted a competition for your society, right? So you can talk about that competition, right? That this competition was aimed at these things. It helped in, like, this was the thing that I did. It helps proving your management skills, that I successfully managed like 400, 500 people, or I successfully managed this competition or this fest. We were able to bring in a lot of big names and we successfully managed the entire competition or the entire fest. It acts as a talking point and it showcases your leadership or management skills, right? That you were leading a team of, let's say, 20 juniors, and you, like, completed the task and stuff like that. So it acts as a talking point as well, that you are good at managing stuff and you are good at, like, multitasking, or let's say you're good at leadership skills. So this is what position of responsibilities plays in your CV. After that, it's all about extracurricular achievements. Let's say if you took part in a competition and you won, like, first, second, third, something like that, then that should be also put in your CV. And that is very important, right? Because it, again, shows proficiency, that you are proficient at winning multiple competitions. Let's say you are applying for a position in consulting companies and you have actually won 2-3 case studies beforehand, right? So it helps showcasing that you are good at solving case studies and you have actually won a few competitions in that sphere, right? It again acts as a talking point that, yeah, let's say the manager can, the interviewer can ask you questions like, what was the topic of your competition? If it's a very good competition, you can ask questions like that. What is the topic of your competition? How did you come up with a solution? What were the ideas that you thought about? So talking on these points and giving them very good ideas, like very, giving them very good solutions, or like talking great about these points helps you score good points in CV in your interview and helps you convert the job, right? So this is the, in a nutshell, what should be there in your CV. First, education qualifications, academic achievements and awards that you have, any internships and work experience, any PORs, positions of responsibilities, and extracurricular achievement. Apart from that, if there is an other information like any technical skills or let's say your hobbies or stuff like that, that should that can be also put in your CV. It's like a line or two can be given for that. And hobbies sometimes acts as a good talking point, but I have not seen a lot of like questions being asked on your hobbies or technical stuff, so it's generally of a little less importance. This is the first format that I wanted to talk about. So, and this is the second format. This format is slightly different from the first one. The first one is what we call a horizontal format, and this is again a vertical format because let's say everything is on the left column of this, right? The entire points are on the left side and in a column way, right? So This is the generally the more preferred format because it helps you like put a lot more things in your CV. And apart from that, it also like helps in highlighting a lot of stuff which cannot be highlighted in the horizontal format or which may get lost in a horizontal format. I'll show you what I'm talking about when I show you the examples of a CV. So let's say one of the major things that has like recently been added in a lot of CVs is the number of online courses that you have done, right? So this is something that can also be like put on your CV and helps you showcasing proficiency in a lot of things. There's a lot of courses given on by in Coursera, Udemy, stuff like that, and that should go under your academic achievements and awards. So if you have done those certifications, those certainly help in adding plus points to your CV, and more importantly, they serve as a talking point. Let's say, talking from a personal experience, I had a course on advanced valuation and strategy, and in, let's say, of the five finance interviews that I gave, in the four interviews, I was asked questions on advanced valuation and strategy. So it helped me like drive the interview in my favor and in my direction and helped me talk about that course, right? So if I do good on that part, then I'm certain that I will grab that interview, right? So then again, this is what your CV should all be about. It should be about talking points. It should be a reflection of yourself, what you have done till date, and it should give a lot of talking points to the interviewer, so he can help you. So it can help him understand you better. It can help him understand whether you are a good fit for the company or not, and help him understand whether you have the technical capabilities for the job that is required or not. So this is one thing. Apart from that, the second most important thing in your CV, which I want to like talk about, I'll show this resume guide. Yeah. So is the use of action verbs for your resume, because with modernization and let's say in the last 2 to 3 years, what happens whenever you apply to a company is that they do not have an HR checking your CV first. They have sophisticated AI machines which scan your CV, look for keywords in your resume and whether those keywords are matching with the job description that is posted or not. And they, on the basis of AI only, they have a lot of software for that, make the decision whether should the CV should be passed on to the HR manager or not, or should it be rejected. So it's very important that you have a lot of action words on your resume which match the job description that you are like for the job description for the job that you are applying for, right? And that is why you should always change your CV and tailor your CV for each and every company that you're wanting to apply, right? Because the job description varies, and because there are softwares which now pick keywords from the job description and look for those in your CV, it's very important that you tailor your CV for each and every company that you apply, right? Because let's say there is a job description with the keyword of managing a lot of things, right? The job descriptions want you to be multitasker, or let's say managing 2 to 3 things at once. So they are looking for the keywords managed. Is your managed keyword on your CV? Let's say if you have a fest or stuff like that and you write coordinated instead of managed, it can be possible that the software itself does not screen your CV. It gets screened out in the first stage itself and does not go to the hiring manager. So it's important that you use keywords from the job descriptions and put them in your CV so that it can be like, it showcases that you are relevant for the position and it helps you in getting a better shortlist. So these are the a lot of keywords, action words, verbs, which we say in, let's say, in CV technical language. For resume, there are certain words for, like, let's say, for each and every category. Let's say if you have a leadership skills, you accomplish something, you achieve something, you accomplished, organized, handled, headed. So these spearheaded, prioritized, increased, these are the, let's say, keywords for leadership. For communication, you suggested some, like, let's say, for internships and for work experience, it's very important. Like, you suggested key methods to increase the revenue by 10%, or you suggested key things that helped in increasing increasing sales by a factor of 2%, 2 times or stuff like that. So these are all very important keywords that can be used for research. What did you do? You collected data, you diagnosed the data, you interpreted the data, then you resolved some questions or queries, stuff like that. For technical, there's keywords like remodeled, like you remodeled some software or something like that, which can be used, programmed, upgraded, streamlined. Like let's say the data collection process was very mundane, so you streamlined the data collection process and helped in reducing the data collection time from, let's say, 3 hours to 1 hour. These are type of things that you can put in your CV. And similarly, there are a lot of action words that can be used, and I think you should use all these action words if possible in your CV. Apart from usage of action words, the second most thing is quantifying your data, right? That is very important, because quantifying helps you put a number to a thing, right? Let's say you won a competition. That's very good. But if I say that I won a competition with 4 competitors, and if I say that I won a competition with 1,000 competitors, which one is more impactful, right? The one with the 1,000 competitors. Or let's say I helped in increasing the sales of my company, or I helped in increasing the sales of my company by 150%. Which one is more impactful? The one which is quantified, right? So it's very important that you quantify your achievements in each and every step, and you put those quantifiable achievements in your CV. So that helps the interviewer understand better. Like it gives them a good idea that by how much did you increase, or like by what quantity did you actually make a difference in that organization or in that work that you were doing, right? So it gives you plus points instead of, like, let's say only bare things like that you did something XYZ, but what was the effect of that XYZ? Like, let's say you headed a team of 20, but what was the effect of that? So giving that cause and effect relationship, that this was the thing that you did and its effect was on these many people, or it affected in this X way, is very important. So you should always, when you write a point in your CV, it should have a cause and effect relationship, that this is the work you did and this was the effect of that work and this was the result or the achievement of that work, and you should quantify that result or achievement or stuff like that. So this is very important. These are the two things very crucial for you when you are making your CV, is one thing that you use action verbs. The second thing is that you quantify your achievements. So this helps you in making your CV stand out from your peers or from your groups. Apart from that, these are some of the resume tips that are given by, this is actually the Harvard resume guide. So these are some of the resume tips that they give, and I completely agree with them. That is why I'll show you, I'm just sharing this with you. So top 5 resume mistakes: spelling and grammar errors. Please ensure that there are no spelling or grammar errors, because it showcases that you are not serious about making your CV, right? Because let's say CV is a reflection of yourself. It showcases, it stands for you, right? It's the selling product for you, right? If you make mistakes in that thing, it showcases that you are not serious about applying for the job, or you're not serious. So this is one of the major mistakes that should not be committed. Missing email or phone information. It's important that you have email or telephone number in your CV, or else how they will contact you. Using passive language instead of action words. I have already discussed that. Not well organized, concise, or easy to skim. So this, again, I have told them, and too long. So we obviously know that we should not have too long resumes. What should we actually do is be consistent in format and content. Consistency is very important. Do not use a lot of colors on your CV, like red, white, black. Just stick with a normal color, black or white, or let's say what I use is a 3 color scheme, black, blue, and white. This is the scheme that I use. Make it easy to read and follow, balancing white space. I will show you why balancing white space is important. Use consistent spacing, underlining, italics, bold, and capitalization for emphasis. Do not overdo this stuff, because I have seen a lot of CVs where everything is bold or underlined, or everything is like in italics. Then the importance of like doing like bolding something goes away, right? Because everything is in bold. So that is very important. And apart from this, I would tell you there are two main fonts that can be used for making CV. One is Calibri, Calibri, and second is Cambria. these are the two main fonts that are used for making CV. Do not use Times New Roman because it's very sharp. So it actually like does not look good in the eyes. But when I'm seeing like a Times New Roman font CV of 1200 words written on one page, it does not look good. So Cambria or Calibri, these are the two fonts that are widely used. You can stick with these two fonts, or you can like play around or like use other fonts as well if you want to. List headings such as experience in order of importance, that is important. And apart from that, in reverse chronological order with most recent information first, avoid information gaps. And the last thing that is like highlighted a lot in by a lot of like recruiters if you are on LinkedIn is that naming your file incorrectly. Let's say you just named your file 1.pdf and send it to the recruiter. How will you know whose CV is that? So you ensure that you use proper naming traditions when you are like sending your CV. I use a basic naming technique, that is my name, resume, Abhishek Sancheti resume. Yeah. So, and apart from that, what are the major don'ts for your CV? Do not use personal pronouns. You should never like talk in first person when you are writing your CV. Your CV should always be in third person. It should always be written from a perspective of third person individual. It should never be in first person. So no I, stuff like that. Do not abbreviate your CV until it's a very common abbreviation. So let's say ICAI is okay, but do not abbreviate stuff which is not so common, right? Because let's say a person may not be familiar with it. So I have done FRM, so I write the entire full form of FRM because a lot of people may not be familiar with the full form of FRM. So do not use a narrative style. Your CV should be clear, concise, and in points. Do not use a narrative style, that is not good. It should not include a picture. There is no requirement of you having a picture in your CV. It's unnecessary, and no need of including references or stuff like that. So resume language should be specific rather than general. It's very important for stuff like internships or for positions of responsibility. Be specific in what you have done, right? Do not write general things that you did that XYZ. If you have done a very specific thing, write about the specific thing. That would gain you more points. It would help you in acting as a better talking point when you are like talking, when you are like giving an interview. It should be use active rather than passive. It should be written to express, right? A CV is a culmination of what you have actually done. So there is no need to impress someone. If you have done what you think is impressive, it would absolutely impress others as well. So it's no need that you have to write it impress someone. Just write it to express yourself that this is who I am, and if it's impressive enough, it's impressive enough, right? So it should be articulate, fact-based, quantify and qualify. You should quantify stuff, and written for people who scan quickly. It's a saying that there is only a 10-second that we have only a 10-second attention span, and a lot of CVs are shortlisted on basis of that 10 seconds only. So if your CV is good enough on those 10 seconds, it will be shortlisted, right? So it should be scannable enough, like on a one glance, I could be able to judge whether if you have done a lot or not, or if you are the right person for the job or not. So that is also very important. So I think these are the technical points. I have shared a lot of technical points and a lot of technical things. What should be there and what should not be there in a CV. I'll show you an example of a CV. So this is my CV right now. Yeah. So this is my CV right now. If you can see that it has on top, I use a slightly different format from CV format 2. It's basically the CV format 2, but instead of writing my name in the middle, I write it on the top left side. And after that, I have educational qualifications bucket. It's simple, but it's fairly simple. Like After that, there's academic achievements and awards. I have done FRM, so I have made a different box for that. A lot of you may have a lot of actuarial papers, right? So you can either club it into educational qualifications like examinations, actuarial paper, CT1, CT2, year, name of the institution, institute, IFOA, or let's say the UK one or India one, board be same ho gaya, and performance your marks. You can either do that in your educational qualifications stuff, or you can make an entire box for that. If you have a lot of papers, let's say 7 or 8 papers, you can list them here as well. So I generally prefer a box one because it showcases that apart from my normal educational qualifications, I've also done extra stuff like this, extra professional courses, and that is why I make a different box. If you have done a lot of courses on Udemy or let's say Coursera, you can put that as well here. Like I have one valuation and strategy course I have put here, and I have some NISM papers that I've done, so I put there. After that, if you have internships, you can put those internships. I have, as you can see, I've used a lot of action words, responsible, developed, prepared. So these can be also used. Action words is very important. After that, if you're like, I do not have any work experience, I have campus offers, so I've put those campus offers there. If after that, in positions of responsibility from my college, I've used again action words, spearheaded. What was the effect of that? Spearheaded a team of 70 members. What was the effect? This is a cause. The effect is to coordinate recruitment dives of 150 plus companies, right? So for 1600 students. So this is my impact that I have generated. So it's very important that you write what was your cause, like what did you do and what impact it had. Another thing is that, let's say I prepared question papers for India's first, second NEO National Economics Olympiad, and that had an effect on 4,900 students, right? So cause and effect there again. So it's very important that you have stuff like that. If you have research papers and publications, I had a lot of those, so I made a box for that. And after that, it's simple ECA, extracurricular achievements and activities and achievements. Very important that you mention it in descending order, with the most recent being the first. And these are the case studies and business competitions that I've participated in. So it's all in descending order. And I think this is entire, this is like my CV. It was like the top 5 CV of SRCC. And yeah, this is one of, this is a my friend CV. He follows CV format too. So my CV is written in Cambria. His headings are in Cambria, but his like the internal writings are all in Calibri. So yeah, that's different. He has a lot of courses and certifications. He made a different box for that. And he like a lot of you can also do this, like my friend has done. He has mentioned his top achievements, like he has mentioned his top achievements in the form of like a box in the on the beginning of the CV itself, which helps in like telling that, yeah, these are the top 5 achievements that he has done. He is good in, he has done an internship for Walmart. He has been part of Business Conclave. He has an internship for Ernst & Young. Like, he has been associated with Ernst & Young. He has done a lot of social endeavors, and he's good at sports. So it's top achievements. He has like made small boxes for them and written in below his name only, so that the recruiter can give a glance to that as well, right? So it's fairly simple. It's like same like my CV only. This was the difference that he had, so I wanted to showcase you this as well. Yeah. I think I am done with like telling you about like CVs. Yeah, now I have to talk about shortlist, right? So I told you about the shortlist for consulting companies. For a lot of consulting companies, they take your entire CV into consideration, and they shortlist you on the basis of the marks they give to your CV. So for McKinsey, the cutoff score is 38 out of 40, and it's same like more or less same for top three like MBB, McKinsey, Bain, BCG. They all have like 38, 37 cutoffs. So this is for consulting companies. For finance companies, let's say for JP Morgan, Nomura, you need to have really good ACADs. They do not take your CV into entire consideration. Like for a shortlist into a JP Morgan, you need to have brilliant ACADs. They only look at your academic achievements first, and they shortlist on the basis of that only. After that, there is, like, let's say, a test or stuff like that. And when you perform well in that test, then you get a call for an interview. So this is the pattern that is followed in finance companies. And for, let's say, other companies like marketing, product management, I think it won't be relevant to you. But for them, they take your entire CV into consideration, but they do not have any marking or stuff like that. If it's good, they shortlist you, and they have, like, a lot of talking points, right? So I think this is all that I have to say for now. If any of you have questions, then I think we can take those questions further. I hope that this session has not been a bore till now. Any questions?
Hello, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, like you said that you, I mean, in your CV, you have done a lot of internships. I've seen that. So can you just tell me, how do you get those internships? Because I have been trying to apply for a lot of internships, but even if I get an internship, it's not related to what I want to do further in my life, in my career.
Okay. So yeah, so for that, I think this is a very valid question. In my CV, I only have one internship. My friend has actually done three internships, the second CV that I showed you. And I think at this stage, a lot of internships, that it's very hard to get good internships. Good internships can only be found if, like, from campus only. If you get those, then it's good enough. Otherwise, it's very hard to get internships. I would suggest that you use LinkedIn a lot. In LinkedIn, but you have to be very careful, right? Because there are two types of companies in LinkedIn. One is that there are a lot of companies that are offering internships, but they are actually unpaid, right? 90% of those unpaid internships are useless, senseless. They do not add anything to your CV, and it's a total waste of time. I would suggest you do not do that. But if you scout LinkedIn a lot, there is a possibility that you can find good internships there. And let's say if you are an actuarial student and you want something in the actuarial field, then it's very difficult right now. But try and look for companies, companies which are very niche, or they are not very large organizations in actuarial field, right? If there is a small organization, then there is a possibility of you getting an internship. You can talk. If you are on LinkedIn, you can connect with any executives from that company and try and talk with them, or let's say have a conversation, or let's just say that I'm a student looking for an internship and message them. So this is how a lot of students at SRCC and other colleges also try and look for internships, and a majority of them are successful in doing that. Apart from that, if you look for internships, you can also look at A, LinkedIn, other, and B, you can get an internship at a Big Four also, if that is in your field or in your area of expertise. For Big Four internships, LinkedIn is the best place. You can get an unpaid internship very easily in a Big Four from LinkedIn if you connect with the right people. So yeah, that's that. Any questions?
You all can ask your questions in the chat box as well. There's one question in the chat box, Abhishek.
Oh, okay. Oh, gender and date of birth is necessary to mention. Not important. We had to mention it because it was like our CV vetting rules. Our CVs were vetted, it was verified by the placement cell in SRCC and in a lot of these school colleges. So they have certain rules and regulations about what you should put and what you should not put. And there are some things that have to be put in your CV. So gender and date of birth was one of those necessities. Yeah, it's not important that you have to put in your CVs. Any questions?
There's one question in chat box.
Okay. Do we need to add a LinkedIn profile URL as a hyperlink in the CV? You can do that, but it's not necessary, right? Because let's say, what would generally be the course of, let's say, applying to a company? If you apply through your LinkedIn profile, or let's say if you apply through LinkedIn, the manager, or let's say if he calls for calls you for an interview or asks you to share your CV, he would have looked at your profile, right? After looking at your profile, he would have suggested that we can take this case forward and we can look at his or her profile for this job. So it's not necessary that you can to put your LinkedIn URL on your CV, but it can be done. And let's say if you are applying from the other way around as well, directly to the company with the help of your CV, a lot of managers nowadays look at LinkedIn profiles as well. So you can put that, you cannot put that, it does not make a difference, right? It's not a very good big point. So in the position of responsibility, can we mention experiences from our high schools like grade 12 or 11 or just university one? Yeah, you can mention, it's beneficial if you mention, let's say if you have a position of responsibility in your, like, let's say university, if because the recent the better. If it's the most recent, the better. But even if it's not, if you do not have, you can mention your position of responsibility from grade 11 or grade 12. That's not an issue. What I personally feel is the cutoff for mentioning things on your CV is class time. So let's say for a fresher, or let's say for 1 year work experience, the maximum thing that you should mention on your CV should not be below class 9. Everything class 9 or class 10 above. Can I mention about my family business? So it depends on what context, right? Let's say if you actively participate in your family business, yeah, you can mention that you are that you run this business or you are a part of this business and you do these things as well, because it will again be a type of a work ex, right? So yeah, in that context, you can mention about your family business. Do we need to tweak our CVs every time depending on the company we are applying for? If so, what details should be changed? Yeah, it's recommended that you tweak your CVs. You do not have to tweak a lot, right? Let's say, what do you mean here by, let's say, changing your CV? Let's say you are applying for a company, let's say Dahlberg. Okay, so Dahlberg is a very big name in consulting and they do a lot in social consulting. So let's say if you have if you have some social volunteering, let's say you have participated in an NGO or have done some social work, right? Those may be not necessarily a part of your CV, right? Let's say if you are applying for a finance company, then those are not necessary. But if you are applying for a company like Dahlberg, then they become highly important. So this is what I mean by tweaking your CV for the company that you apply. Is to see that what field is the company in, what type of job responsibility, what type of job is the company looking for, and just make some little changes in your CV to ensure that you are like relevant to that company, right? If you have a very finance profile and you're applying to a consulting company, does not make any sense, right? But if you have some consulting projects also mentioned in your CV, which are directly relevant to the consulting company you're applying, it adds a lot. After doing research papers, where can we get them verified from? Every time I did a research paper, I did it under the, let's say, guidance of my college professor. So I could get it verified from my college professor only. Apart from that, if you write a research paper without any guidance, there are a lot of publications where you can get your research paper published. It's not important that you get your research paper published in a very high publication. You can get it in any publication. And that can act as a verification for your research paper. Can I please share my sample CV? It's on my LinkedIn. So my LinkedIn ID is Abhishek Sancheti. If you search, you will find me. My CV is posted there. You can see from there only. Do we need to mention address? Then again, not necessary, because the company has two things to contact you. He or she has the email ID and your phone number. So it's not, so address is not required, do not mention it. What if we never participated in college activities? Not an issue. As I said, there are very few companies that look at your entire CV when they are shortlisting. It's majorly consulting companies which look at your entire CV. Apart from that, if you have good attach, if you had good score, that is the topmost thing which is required. I know people in my college who have CVs just like me, but their ACADs are low and they do not get any shortlist in major companies, because major companies shortlist on the basis of your ACAD score. So it's important that it's okay if you have not participated in college activities, ensure that your marks is high. That is the most important thing which is required for like any job. What should the basic CV look like just for internship? See, I have told you entire things that there can be in a CV. If you can take a lot of those boxes, that's good enough. So yeah, being an average student, I do not have educational achievements, then what should be done? It's okay if you do not have educational achievements. Then again, there are companies that look at your entire CVs, right? If you have a good enough score. Apart from that, if you have done something in your in, let's say, in each and every box that's good enough, then you can, like, your CV will get shortlisted. That's not necessary, because see, CV is only a part of the entire process. It's not the end, right? If you the work of the CV, as I mentioned earlier, is two things: first, getting a shortlist; second, being a talking point. It's okay if you do not have a lot of academic achievements or educational achievements. It does not matter, right? It anyways does not serve as a talking point, so it will be useless in an interview. But first thing, if you get your CV shortlisted, and to get your CV shortlisted, two things are important: either your entire CV is good enough, or the second thing, your marks is good. If you cross that hurdle, and the marks barrier is very less in, let's say, a lot of companies, if you pass that barrier, and for, let's say, an actuarial for actuarial roles, it will be even less, because your actuarial scores would be important, or the number of papers you have completed important would be, right? So after that, you just pass that hurdle in an interview. If you have few talking points in your CV, it would be helpful for you, because it will help steer the interview in your direction, right? So it will help steer your interview in your direction, and you would be comfortable with what you are talking about, and it will be helpful for you to score points on your interview and help getting the job that you want, right? So that is the major part of that. What if someone has no internships but tried their own startup? You can obviously mention that instead of internships that you had the startups. Then again, quantify if you were able to get any funding or any mentorships, mentoring from any well-known individuals, mention those. I have a friend who had a startup, but it failed. But even after that, he got a lot of shortlists, because he was able to quantify the achievements, what he had done, and he had got mentoring from a very good individual in that field. So yeah. Is it okay if I haven't done any internships? Totally okay. Let's say I am going to a B school where, let's say I am Bangalore, where people have 4 years of work ex, and I'm going with zero work ex, right? So it's okay, not an issue. How important are certificates, like if we learn something from free and open sources? See, this is a very important point, right? 2 years beforehand, it added a lot to your CV, like courses from Coursera and Udemy. But what has been the trend nowadays is that a lot of, like, everyone does those courses, right? So it does not add a lot while shortlisting your CV. Like, it does not add much in getting your CV shortlisted. But after your CV is shortlisted, during the point of interviews, it can act as a very good talking point, and then again, steer interview in your direction. So that is important. If I had done an internship, but it wasn't in the field I'm applying for, would it be right to mention in the CV? Very good question. It depends on what type of a company you are applying. Okay. So if, let's say, any company wants WorkEx or wants internships, and it's very important for shortlisting in that criteria, you can apply. You can, like, put those things. But let's say if a company is okay with zero internship or zero WorkEx, then do not put. So I'll tell you why. Because let's say if you get shortlisted, and when it comes to your interview, it can actually backfire. It acts as a double-edged sword. In one hand, it showcases that you have work experience, or let's say an internship experience. But on the other hand, it raises questions like, why do you want to switch from this role to this role, right? Or why did you do an internship in this thing, and why do you want to come to this field now? So it raises unnecessary questions. But if you can tackle those questions, and then there would be not an issue. If you can successfully tackle that, I wanted to explore this field, but I found that this field is not that great for me. And then I did a lot of courses and stuff like that in the field that I'm applying for particular for right now, and I feel that this is the course for me. If you can tackle questions like these and can answer well, you can mention it. I'm a finalist and semi-finalist some competition, but I have only participation certificate. Should I mention these in my resume? Yes, if you are finalist and semi-finalist, you can mention those in your resume, not an issue. If your resume is not graded, right? If it's not vetted, if there is no verification process, you can, like, write those in your interview, but ensure that you have some proof, some type of proof for that, right? Because a lot of times companies ask for background verification or for CV verification, right? There has been times that companies have asked for proofs for something that has been written in the CV. So it's imperative if you have participation certificates, not an issue. But if you have some kind of a proof, let's say a WhatsApp proof, or let's say if you can get it written from the email ID of the competition that you participated, if you can get it from the organizers that you are finalist or semi-finalist, it's okay. Is it not necessary to mention hobbies or interests separately? No, you can put it together also, not an issue. Then again, it does not add much if it's something that helps in personalizing your CV. So if you have space, you can mention hobbies or interests, not an issue. What is the right way to mention personal skills and abilities like communication, problem solving, etc.? The best thing would be to showcase a time when you actually helped in doing this, right? Let's say if you helped in solve, if you solved the problem of an organization, or let's say if you solved a problem while you were, let's say, a member of your, let's say if you have a position of responsibility or a member of a society and you helped in solving a problem of that society, right? So just put it there also. If it adds a lot to your CV if you can showcase skills with the help of an example. Like if you write skills like you have communication skills, problem solving skills, it's good enough. But what actually adds a lot of value to those is that if you can like quantify or justify those skills. If you can showcase examples, this is not just for CV, this is for interviews as well. Like when recruiters ask you what are your top three strengths or top three weaknesses or stuff like that, always give examples. Like this is my strength, these are few instances where I showcase this strength. This helps in justifying your answer, right? So it adds a whole lot of adds a lot of quality to your answer. Let's say if I just say that my skill is like communication or problem solving, okay, what? So but if I give four examples where I showcase those skills, then it adds a lot to my answer, right? Should position of responsibility include of my internships work, as it already mentioned in intern heading? Okay, so I think this is a question where a lot of things that you did in your internship also is the same things that you did in your position of responsibility. I'm guessing that is the question. You can see in those, so in that case, I think you can use a little bit of tact or a little bit of skill. If it's the same work, use two different methods of writing those, because if let's say if you have space in your CV and your position of responsibility, you do not have other things to write about, just ensure that it does not look like the same thing that you have written in your internship. Just change it up a little bit and write it. Okay. Given that we have spent the last 2 years at our home giving online exams, do you think that our graduation scores would really matter? I think it matters even more now, because I'll just give you the ground reality right now. You have spent last 2 years at your home giving online exams. Others have spent those last 2 years at home giving online exams plus doing courses from Udemy, Coursera. A lot of them trying to start their own startups. A lot of them doing their internships, stuff like that. And see, these are not that add any points to your CV. Okay, so these are internships that are like given on free in LinkedIn and does not add anything to your CV. And they are basically worthless, a lot of these things. But nowadays, because everyone has everything on their CV, the companies have resorted to only two things majorly for shortlisting. Let's say for companies which look at your entire CV, if they know the name of your college, were you part of a good society in that college? Do you have a good company name on your CV for internship or stuff like that? And do you have high graduation scores? So I'll just give you a real-time example of, let's say, for in the case of SRCC, I think for internships this year, like in my year, the cutoff was for some companies 9 GPA, but it has gone up to 9.3 GPA this time because a lot of them has online exams have got 3 marks and got a higher marks. So their cutoffs for internships, like for cutoffs for like getting shortlisted in tests and interviews, has gone up from 9 to 9.3 GPA. So yeah, marks is very important. Are dramatics related certificates of any value? It's of very important value, again, because dramatics showcases that you have proficiency in one thing, right? it's very it can help you gain a lot of points for, let's say, company, for all companies, but for specifically for, let's say, consulting companies, because they like thing, they like if you have a proficiency in any field. It does not matter what field do you have. I have seen people from SRCC who have played table tennis all their life and who are, like, let's say, a very good table tennis player, nationally ranked and national level captain, getting shortlisted in McKinsey. And I have seen people who are like the head of the Dramatic Society of SRCC getting shortlisted for McKinsey. So if you have dramatics related certificate, it's very cool. Like, you can add those on your CV, not an issue. Do you think endorsements of LinkedIn hold any value on getting placed? I do not think so. Like, LinkedIn is still evolving. So, right, a lot of having a lot of endorsements add, I think, a percent or two to your overall profile. It adds genuinity, but it does not help in, like, getting any placements or stuff like that till now. Any other questions?
Okay, so I think there were a lot of questions. It was a really good, nice session, enriching session, Abhishek. Thank you so much. So Abhishek, as he had mentioned, that he has completed his FRM and he'll be joining IIM Bangalore. And also he has participated in lot many extracurricular activities, as we have seen, MUNs, business competition, quizzes, debates, etc. So this was a really interesting and enriching session for all of us. Thank you so much, Abhishek, for this.
Not an issue. Yeah, okay. I hope that it was a good session and I did not bore you guys a lot. And I hope
it was a really good session. Thank you so much. So if you all have any questions, you all can connect with Abhishek on his LinkedIn. And yes, thank you so much for attending today's session.